Okay, good afternoon, everybody. It's my distinct pleasure to start today's WIND seminar series, with our speaker being Edward Dreisen from New Jersey Institute of Technology. Edward received his MS in molecular physics and his PhD in applied physics, both from Odessa State University in the Ukraine in 85 and 92, respectively. He then immigrated to the United States and joined the research staff of AeroChem Research Labs at Princeton, New Jersey, in 93. And then in 1999, he became a faculty member, as if you've already seen, the New Jersey Institute of Technology at Newark, New Jersey, where he's presently a distinguished professor of chemical engineering as well as associate chair of graduate studies at the OH York Department of Chemical, Biological, and Pharmaceutical Engineering. He co-authored and authored more than 220 peer-reviewed journal articles and naturally multiple conference papers and proceedings. He has advised 15 PhD graduates and multiple MS and undergrad researchers. In addition to all of that, he serves as an associate editor for the International Journal of Energetic Materials and Chemical Propulsion, and he's furthermore also a member of the International Editorial Council for Combustion, Explosion, and Shockwaves, and of the editorial board of International Journal of Self-Propagating High-Temperature Synthesis. Please welcome with me Dr. Ed Dreisen. His seminar is entitled Mechanically, Chemically Prepared Nanocomposite Reactive Materials. Ed, please
go ahead. Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon. And I first would like to thank John and the Institute for having me here. It's my pleasure to be here. I'm enjoying seeing the facilities and talking to people. It's really seems very productive so far. So I'll talk about chemically prepared nanocomposite reactive materials. And this is work supported by various agencies, mostly Department of Defense related in the US. So just to introduce you, what am I going to talk about? It's sort of like a, what are reactive materials? And if some of you know, I apologize for telling you stuff you know already. But basically, those are materials that burn with large amount of energy released, but they do not detonate. So that separates them from explosives, conventional or propellants. So they typically do not detonate, but they release lots of energy. And this is a picture of magnesium combustion, which is an example of a reactive material, magnesium powder. So it could be pure powders, different metals which have high enthalpy of oxidation. Typically, they have low burn rates, so this is kind of on the disadvantaged side for these materials. It could be composites like metal organic compounds, and aluminum Teflon or magnesium Teflon Viton are common compositions for many applications. The downside here is a low density, but they're somewhat more reactive. There could be a binary systems, stuff that reacts exothermically, like nickel aluminum, boron titanium, boron carbon. So they form aluminides, borides, carbides, and release a lot of heat. And so they would be reactive materials. Could be other type of binary system thermites, which you combine metal and metal oxide and reduce one metal, oxidize the other. These are typically higher energy. And so the range of applications is broad and in all kinds of things. And we'll talk more about this a little bit later. Now, this was reactive material. Now, what's mechanochemistry? So mechanochemistry is really a chemical reaction triggered by mechanically. And so people knew that kind of stuff for a long time. We rub wood to make fire, or we use flint and steel to produce sparks. So this is examples of mechanochemical reactions. Now, they don't always have to produce fire, but they make new materials or make materials react, and that gives rise to mechanochemical material synthesis. And so this term is reserved mostly for making new materials or new compounds by milling, by mechanical milling. So it's something like that. So you have a ball mill, which, it's a picture where you have the balls, you put the powder in, and somehow miraculously you make a new material by just beating it around with the balls. I think it's the most simple material synthesis techniques I ever seen, and it's amazing how versatile and productive this method is. So energy is transferred from the milling tools, typically balls, to the powder. it only works if the energy of collisions exceeds a particular threshold. If you have a normal roller mill and just slowly rotate the vial and the balls just like roll around there, you only mix materials, but you never make anything new. So you need to exceed the threshold typically to plastically deform material and cause cold welding, or things like that, to make new stuff to appear. And then in a broader sense, now this area is, I think, growing explosively. And it started being really for alloys and maybe dispersion strength reinforced composites. But now we're looking about, in addition to these typical materials, carbides, nitrides, alloys, and composites and nanocomposites, which is mostly our work, we can also functionalizing powders. And now I don't have it on the slide, but we make all kind of organic compounds. And like we have a project now, which is small, but we're nitrating toluene, for example. So we're making nitrotoluene out of toluene, and this is done mechanochemically. So this is a very different area of mechanochemistry. Okay, let me get out of here. So for this work that I'm going to talk about, what's the motivation? We want to combine mechanochemistry and reactive materials. So we want to have reactive materials which have high oxidation enthalpy, approaching that of pure metals. So it's hard to beat oxidation of aluminum or boron because they produce a lot of heat per gram when they form oxides. So this is much higher than gas or any hydrocarbons. So we want to have that enthalpy, but we want to have high heat of reaction, which would be approaching monomolecular energetics, where typically rate of reaction is slow for these guys because it's limited by heterogeneous processes. So we will exploit mechanochemical synthesis as a versatile, scalable, and simple method. And I think this is like the most interesting part. It yields metastable materials, and nanocomposite metastable materials. So why is it interesting? Why nanocomposite metastable makes me excited? So if you look, so this is now bringing together mechanochemistry and reactive materials. If you have a metastable state, you can relax it by, say, heating your material or bumping it or subjecting it to a shock. And if you relax the metastable state, that relaxation can trigger ignition in many different ways. So reactive components, which are metastable, can be mixed on a nanoscale. And so they are really mixed finely, so you reduce diffusion time, but they form micron-sized, fully dense particulates, which are much easier to handle than, let's say, traditional nanomaterials, which are built out of mixed nanopowders or nanoparticles. So the types of materials that you can work with pretty much repeats what I showed before. Mechanically alloyed powders, so you can make metastable alloys in all this case. And in this case, when you relax metastable states, you have pristine metal surface that you form on the spot, right? And you produce defects. And all of those oxidize more rapidly. So ignition can be stimulated by better morphology. And the chemical energy is very small that we add to the reaction. Now we can have intermetallic metal-metalloid compounds, which are composites, rather, nickel, aluminum, boron, titanium, boron, zirconium, and such. So in this case, you have quite an exothermic condensed phase reaction. So when you form, aluminide, borides in this case. And then that reaction heats up material very rapidly to pretty high temperature. And then say that boride, which normally would be inert, if it's that hot, it continues oxidizing if you have oxidizer around. So you keep going on, and that's kind of what's desired. You can have your traditional thermites, and then redox reaction stimulates ignition. That's pretty well understood. You can have also metal organic compounds. And again, aluminum Teflon, for example, you form fluorides. And you also modify morphology. And the nice thing here is that fluorides is a gas, so you disturb your material byproducts. And finally, we deal with all kind of custom compositions. In particular, we spend a lot of time with the metal halogen composites. And that is because halogenated combustion products are biocidal. They kill the spores. And so that's agent defeat type program. If you are concerned about spreading anthrax around as a result of bombing some facility, you want to have that anthrax neutralized right there. So you have to have products which, without really producing a lot of fire destruction, just destroy anthrax spores. And so those halogen halogenated combustion products do just that. Okay, so how does it work? Again, this is, so you have a powder, two colors mean I have two materials. You have milling balls, then you beat them around, and if we look inside like a little rectangle, we will see two balls colliding powders and making flakes, and that's a cross-section of the kind of stuff that you make this way. So you start expanding the ductile parts and the more brittle parts kind of embed themselves in, and you keep doing this, so you start doing this composite, you keep deforming it, and you form more refined structure, and then, you know, you form more and more refined structure, and then the flakes form flakes, and you end up forming more and more complex composite material. And in the end, you end up with the structure refined as much as you want, and all you need to be worrying about is that not to have these components react chemically. So that's kind of the limitation of the process. So again, so for these materials, for reactive materials prepared by ball milling, the applications include all the other applications I mentioned. So we have propellants, and this is, those two pictures show you combustion of a solid propellant. So this is typical propellant. So this is a propellant itself, and that's the surface that's burning. And these bright spots are aluminum particles that come out and burn and fly out. So this is what it kind of looks like. And if you replace aluminum with the mechanically alloyed or ball-milled boron titanium, this is what it looks like. So you see there's many more particles, and they're burning right at the surface. But the loading is the same in both cases. So you have the same amount of solid. It's just that these guys ignite right on the surface, and these guys coagulate and then fly away and then ignite somewhere. So when they ignite on the surface, you get your heat in the combustion chamber, and so that way you use your heat properly, whereas in this case, you lose a lot of energy. You make custom energetic formulations. You have gas generators, like I say, biocidal product generators, burn rate modifiers, heat sources. Then there is interest in reactive structure. So again, in many munitions, the explosive charge is maybe 20% of the mass of the munition, and then the rest, about 70%, is just steel that holds it all together. And that is, like, chemically speaking, dead weight. So if you can make that structure reactive, even though it's not like explosive, just a little bit, you have a lot of mass, so you can add quite a bit to the energy of the munition. Then the peaceful applications are in the reactive soldering and brazing and the welding. You can have your source of heat right at the joint, so that way you don't heat up the entire, say, board that you want to join to, or like a mirror or a target. And you can have a local heat source, and that can be very advantageous. There is energy and hydrogen production, so you can react, say, aluminum and water, make hydrogen for fuel cells and things like that. So there's really a lot of different applications for these materials. A lot of challenges, too. I forgot to mention that part of my talk, which is right now, I'm just giving you a little overall introduction to what the field is, and then I'll get into two cases, and we'll get to a little more science. But before we do, I just want to set the stage. So there is a unique challenge for safety, because we're dealing with reactive materials, so safety is always a challenge. But when you deal with reactive materials, it's particularly important, because you're really making stuff that can ignite and have a huge fire. So you need to prevent reaction during milling. And there are ways of doing this. You just need to be mindful of that. You can carefully recover the materials, which can be reactive. And then storage and shipping is always a challenge, too. So again, all these things are you can deal with. You just need to recognize this and properly acknowledge. Scale-up. So scale-up is a question for any mechanochemical synthesis. And you have different types of milling equipment that you use in the research lab and the industry. And they look different and they operate differently. And so this is always like, how do you go from this little, like a 2-3 gram batch to ton production? And there is a way. I don't have much time to talk about this, but it's based on the modeling of how the energy transferred in different ball mills. And in a model, we can calculate pretty much any, describe any device. And if you know what part of this output to use to predict the progress in your material, then you can really scale it up, and it does work. And you need to scale different characteristics. When you make materials, typically we are inserting them in existing technologies, so you need to ensure compatibility with the other components, binders, processing protocols, storage protocols, et cetera. And in many cases, you want to, so what we do, we control structure. But sometimes you also want to control size distribution and shape of the particles. And that's becoming difficult because your process is tuned to get mixing on a particular scale. And then you like, OK, well, I got this powder, and this is the size distribution I have. And then it turns out, no, this is not what I need. I need a different size distribution to fit with my process. And again, it's a little bit, it's a challenge. You can deal with it, but like we did not recognize this until maybe a couple of years, just when we bumped into a specific application. So I mentioned different types of mills. There is probably no shortage in types of them in the world, but three types of mills have been used to make materials, reactive materials. So this is a shaker mill, and this is a little simulation of how it works. So this is a numerical model, and really you have balls jumping in a vial, and there are different types of ball mills in different countries, and you make 1 to 10 gram in this device, and it's nice because you have a high collision energy, short milling time, you can put the pressure in the vessel, so that's good. Of course, the bad parts is a small batch process, the capacity is small, the controls are limited because typically these devices are not adjustable in terms of frequency. And then it's hard to access real-time measurements because this vial goes back and forth like crazy. The other device is the planetary mill, and so here is one of the vials going. So they go like a planet around the sun, and you put the balls in there. And this is a little complicated motion. It looks very different from the shaker mill. And so when I first started dealing with this, and we had two of these devices in the lab, I said, no way in the world I can get the same material in both devices because they really process material differently. But they do get the same material if you can get exactly the same kind of material. So advantage is larger batch size. They have variable speed, so more controls. You can cool milling compartments, so that's a little more technologically advanced devices. But they are just the lab scale devices, so these guys are not scalable. You can't, like we have the one device which is the biggest lab device you can have, and we can have up to 100 gram per vial, which is great but for the lab, but for the practical application, still not what people want. You can do real-time measurements, and now, like I say, these become very advanced technologically. And so these are devices at Ritter mills, which are scalable now. So here, you just the vial doesn't move. You put an impeller in, and you rotate it. And when it moves, like with the balls, it looks like this. So all these are our simulations of how the process is going. And these simulations actually used to calculate this energy transfer to the milling material from the balls. And so this is a typical union process device. And these guys could be very large, and they can be even configured for continuous production. So the challenge really is to get to this kind of device from any lab kind of device. And we've shown that that's doable. And so in that sense, it's a good thing. There are challenges too. These are not normally sealed well because you have an impeller going in, but there are tricks around it. So and you cannot really do small quantity of the powder because typically the devices are large by design. Ours is the smallest lab design, and this is like for about 50 gram of powder at a time. So this is our equipment that we have. And those are commercial devices. So that's a shaker mill. That's the Ritter mill. This is a planetary mill, and that's like imitation. So what we did here is, so this is just the empty mill that has the impeller going. But this is kind of our unique model, and the unique part about it is that this impeller knows when it collides with the balls, and it adjusts its speed, like in the real case. Because first we did this model, we said impeller just goes like at a given speed, and then we started calculating energy transfer, and we found some unreal things. It just produces so much energy, it's impossible to believe. And then it turns out, in a real device, there is a belt and it's adjusted to a motor. So every time it experiences resistance, it slows down just a little. And this needs to be accounted for to get a completely different energy distribution in the mill than you get when you don't think about that. And that makes a whole difference into how you predict the milling progress. So what we do, we go from one device to another. We work what's called arrested reactive milling, which is we work with reactive materials and we prevent them from reaction. So we stop the milling before they react. We do cryomilling quite a bit. We have liquid nitrogen cooling for this. This is a little cryomill. I didn't talk about that, but it's really a very small quantity of material. We use stage milling, different protocols. So that's, I mentioned, to adjust particle sizes or shapes when you control the structure and the shape. Real-time diagnostics is important for producing materials that you want. And this discrete element modeling, I showed you a couple of videos, and that's what helps us to understand the process of refining and then scale up. So talking about real-time diagnostics and arrested reactive milling, this is probably the key picture to show how the thing works. So in this case, we're milling aluminum and iron oxide. And this is a shaker mill experiment, and this is a thermocouple reading, which is attached to the vial. So in the beginning, this is time, this is temperature. So in the beginning, temperature rises a little bit because the balls just heat around, and we produce thermal energy because of the heat transfer. Then the temperature stabilizes, so we kind of reach some kind of equilibrium. And then this material reacts. So this spike is when the aluminum and iron oxide reacts, and you form aluminum oxide and iron. And so after this spike, this material is of no interest to us anymore because we wanted it to be reactive, and after the spike, it's dead. So in the early work, what we did is we did this once, and then we would stop milling right here. And if we stop milling right here, then we would know that then this material is alive. This is not a very good way of going about it because sometimes this reaction can be really strong, and sometimes you damage the equipment, and you know. So we're now trying to avoid this. Conceptually, though, we're making the same thing. Trying to avoid this reaction is working with the liquid. So if you work with the liquid, you never have, so liquid works as a control agent, also as a coolant. So in the liquid, it's never going like this. It may start reacting slowly. And so if you overmill, you just have partially reacted sample, but part of it's still alive. But you prevent this catastrophic heat release. This is just a couple of slides. I show you pictures what these materials look like. So this is the boron titanium. So you see, so this is 1 micron bar. Particles are less than micron or micron size, but you see each particle has multiple colors. So it's a backscattered electron image. So you see dark is boron and bright is titanium. So they're mixed on a scale of about 100 nanometers, as you see. And the same kind of deal. So this is boron zirconium. So this is big 20 micron bar, just particles as they are. And that's a cross-section particle like this. So again, you see dark inclusions of boron and zirconium matrix. So it's a very finely mixed material throughout the volume. This is a thermite. So again, a picture of a powder is this, 20 micron bar. And that's inside, it's aluminum iron oxide. So you see these little foils of aluminum. And then you see these nanoparticles of iron oxide kind of embedded right into it. So again, this is a very reactive material, which all the interfaces effectively not oxidized, so they can react very, very vigorously. Aluminum moly oxide, same deal, particles, 10 micron inside, aluminum foils and molybdenum oxide inclusions. So molybdenum oxide has completely different structure than iron oxide, and it distributes itself differently. And finally, copper oxide. So there's many particles, so that epoxy, and that's cross-section particles, and that's one of them close up. And if you take this cross-section, and if you analyze distribution of inclusions, so that's that cross-section, and this is analysis of these distributions. So you can see, well, depending on the sample, you have the distribution of sizes for inclusions, and they peak right around 100 nanometers. So that's typical size of your inclusions. Of course, I have to say, we don't see finer inclusions, so like with this resolution, we're missing a bunch. But then again, you know, it's still pretty clear that we have nothing much more than 1 micron, and most of them are much smaller. That gives you a scale of mixing. That's where the nanopart comes in. So what I was talking about were composite materials. And I also mentioned earlier alloys, metastable alloys. So here, if you, for example, mill aluminum and lithium, you can make different materials. So those are X-ray patterns. And so this is aluminum lithium milled for 6 hours, and you readily form intermetallic very quickly. You form intermetallic along with aluminum. If you keep milling this, you pretty much get rid of all the structure. So you have like an amorphous phase which mixes both aluminum and lithium. So the, it's not very clear from these which one is better for energetic applications, but it's just fascinating how you build different structures mechanochemically. So this is all remembered, room temperature. This is two examples of the same kind for aluminum-magnesium alloy. So this is one material which forms solid solution of magnesium in aluminum, and that's the other one which forms in intermetallic phases. So again, you can form either or, and this forms before than this. These two have different compositions, but you form both of those types of phases in all kinds of alloys. They just happen at different milling times. And this is aluminum titanium alloy, and again, you form metastable L1-2 phase of Al3Ti, and if you heat it up, it transforms into a stable phase with the heat release, with the expansion, with the formation of new surface and things like that. So I mentioned reactions, and so this just gives you an overview of kind, it's not all reactions, but those are kinds of reactions that we observe in these composite materials, so the alloys. So aluminum-nickel reaction, aluminum-titanium reaction, aluminum-magnesium reaction, very low heat of formation of the of reaction here, but it's important because it really changes the material structure completely, opens up surface for oxidation. This is very exothermic reactions here, and these are also quite exothermic. So I can't make a table because it's going to be too big, but this is giving you an example of what's happening, and that gives you an idea of, well, a lot of our work here, but there's a lot of work from, you know, from Russia, from Spain, from, again, from Russia here. I guess that's kind of, well, that's the U.S. group, so different people. So how do we quantify these reactions? I think those reactions are very important for us when they trigger ignition. So obviously, we want to understand their mechanism and kinetics. And so here we do what everybody else does. We do thermal analysis. So this shows you, again, an example of a bunch of DSC curves for different materials. And I scale them differently so they can all fit in one plot. And so that way you can see very weak reaction of aluminum magnesium together with a very strong reaction of aluminum copper oxide on the same slide. So the vertical scale is different for each of those traces. But I think the key points are two. One is that every one of them produces exothermic peaks. And second point is all those peaks happen before aluminum melts. So aluminum melting is right here. So all I show you, I specifically cut it here to make sure that all we see is a solid state reaction. So there is no melting going on. So this is important because now this is a low heating rate. And of course, as you start heating it up faster, reactions shift to higher temperatures as they normally do. But still, we have like a lot of room to go to aluminum melting. And so many of these reactions, even in practical cases where we heat them fast, they occur in a solid phase. And that's important from the point of view of stability and how you control it and how you use this kinetics. So I want to show you a little bit of a ranking of these materials. And so this plot is kind of unusual. So what we do here, I plot heat of reaction between components. So for example, boron titanium, or in this case, aluminum molybdenum oxide. So this is the heat of reaction of redox reaction. And this axis shows you a heat of complete oxidation. So if you go from this to Al2O3 and MoO3, so you oxidize everything. And that is plotted for kilojoule per gram, and this is kilojoule per gram. So this shows you just aluminum, right? That's, and then as you start adding molybdenum oxide, you get there, and this is stoichiometric compositions. And the points actually show compositions that have been made experimentally. And so looking at this plot, if I now populate it with many materials, so now I can show you what different materials look like in this matrix. So all the aluminum-based materials kind of come or race from the aluminum, of course. And so now you can see, for example, aluminum Teflon is really a very attractive material because it has high reaction between components and relatively high reaction, you know, oxidation compared to, say, these thermites. So I can compare different thermites. So say magnesium system kind of forms a different ray, and I only have one line here. And boron systems come from here, and they form, you know, different compositions. And this would be, say, TiB, and this is TiB2, right? So, and so each point really represents a material that have been prepared, and mostly we've been preparing those. And so looking at this, you can say, okay, how much heat it releases before it starts burning, and then how much heat do you expect to get when it burns. So that's a useful matrix to select materials energetically. The other kind of overview plot is to see milling dose. So milling dose is the energy you transfer from milling tools to the powder to make a material like this. And we just made this plot recently, and I was kind of hoping it's going to be a little more telling. I was hoping for some kind of trend, but you know, trend doesn't come out. It just, what it is, what it is. You know, that this is, those are our experimental points, how much kilojoule per kilogram of powder you need to put in to get the interesting material. So to us, this is like a reference, a convenient thing to look at, but if you start making a new material, I think it's also useful to have this kind of stuff in front of you so you know where you belong and what kind of stuff to expect. So this is just all kinds of materials that we've made so far. So these are all kind of thermites, metal metalloid compounds, organics, metal metal composites, and then halogen. Like I said, we do a lot of work now with the biocidal materials. So I keep updating this table, and I don't keep up because we keep trying new compositions. This is really a very rich area, and you can try all sorts of things. And really, any material can work. Okay, so with this, let me switch gears and let me talk a little more about the mechanisms and reactions in these materials. And so I'll talk about two things. So the common theme is that some of these composite materials, they have very unusual reaction mechanisms and that you don't see anywhere else. So one example I'll talk about is ignition of nanothermites, which involves rapid formation of metastable oxidizer phases. So during the ignition, we form something intermediate, which really affects ignition, and I'll show you what. So what happens really is that the oxidizer, which is metal oxide, it decomposes and produces oxygen gas. And this is very unusual because this oxygen gas is forming in presence of aluminum, which is a huge reducing agent. So aluminum wants all the oxygen it can take, and yet we release some of that oxygen outside. So this is very unusual, and I'll try to explain to you how it happens and why. And that, you know, that affects really how the stuff ignites. And the other thing really, well, another way of asking, saying this title is, do nanocomposite materials remember that they're nanocomposites once they ignite? Once we exceed the melting point of the low melting part, do they remember that they've been nano at some point? And it turns out that, you know, there are conditions that, depending how you heat them up, can change how they burn, and they can remember. And I think this is a fascinating result, and it's sort of a new project we're starting with just like half a year in, but I think it's a very unusual thing. So first, about ignition. So we talk about kinetics of reaction because, you know, we talk about ignition, and we wanted to understand how these nanothermites ignite. So we did all the usual things, which many people do. So we did all the thermal analysis. We've done experiments in different environments. We've done it at different rates. So to get kinetics, we even did some very low heating rate or even isothermal experiments at very low temperatures to detect reactions and find intermediate products. And once we've done all that, so I'm kind of skipping like three, four papers here just to give you an idea. And we got the kinetics from these experiments. And once we got the kinetics, we're going to validate them by different types of ignition experiments. So that was our idea. So we will do kinetics from these low heating rate experiments, get activation energies, formulas, everything, plug them in the model, predict what's going to happen at a high heating rate, and see if it works. Okay. So this is like our DSC curve, so a bunch of thermites. I'm not going to show you much. I'll just to remind you, this is what we're dealing with. We start reaction at very low temperatures. It's interesting stuff is before aluminum melts. We've done this, it's multi-step reaction, so we've done this at multiple heating rates. We kind of had a model describing all these steps. And then we validated it, so this is somewhat less common experiment. It's using microcalorimeter, and these are isothermal measurements. So this is time, and that's rate of heat release, so that's the actual measurement, and you see the temperatures here, right? So it's like starting pretty much at the room temperature. So we are heating up the thermite, and we're sensing the reaction, which is interesting, you know? And then, you know, we can convert it into heat release integral or thickness of aluminum oxide that grows. And you know, very small thicknesses, but, you know, not, not negligible. And this gives us the kinetics at very low temperatures. So it's interesting for aging in its own way. But for us, this was input for kinetics. OK, done with kinetics. Now here's our model. So I show you here how well it matches the experiment. So I show you one of the cases for copper oxide. So dashed line is our experiment, and solid line is our model. So to me, that looks really good. We don't predict all these like eutectic endothermic peaks, which we did not put in the model. But we predict how the shape of the trace is and how it changes as a function of heating rate. So like all of those traces calculated with the same set of kinetic parameters, so we're done adjusting. So it works. So we know that we can predict our DSC well. OK, so now comes the like a important point. Let's compare this with the ignition stuff. So this is our ignition experiment, the simple one. So we have a little wire. We put a little powder, like a thin layer paint on top of the wire. We heat this wire electrically. And at some point, so we have a heating ramp. Temperature goes up linearly. And at some point, this stuff ignites. And when it ignites, we see it optically. And we, on the other hand, monitor wire temperature. So we have temperature as a function of time and instant of ignition. And so, you know, this is the kind of result we have. So I just show you a big picture. We're not interested in all these data, but aluminum ignites at high temperature. Magnesium ignites at much lower temperature. And these are aluminum-based thermites. They all ignite at like lower temperatures. So in itself, it's a good result, nice to show to the sponsors. But for us, it was more important to see how this changes as a function of heating rate. And we had that. And so now we're ready to compare with our calculations. All right, so this is my model that I showed you before, right? That's the same comparison. Now, this calculation done for DSC experiments, so temperature is controlled. So I only change temperature in the, like I do in the instrument. I have a program, and I change it. This is a different calculation. I use the same kinetics. I don't change it. I now have a high heating rate of the wire, which is experimental heating rate. And instead of programmed temperature, I really calculate the heat transfer from the wire to the powder coating and then heat losses to the environment. So I have a full heat transfer model here. And this is, flow in the powder coating. So when I look at this, first thing I say, OK, great. It has a spike. And it has a spike right where I want it. It's just about where I see ignition. So good, my model predicts something, which is ignition. And I think some more about this, and this is not really ignition, because my spike is very short, right? So my spike goes down right away. So I really don't ignite. My real stuff burns like crazy. And here it's like, OK, I see a spike very short in time, and it cools off right away. So something is off. And now we're thinking, what's off? So to think what's off, we kind of repeated this experiment in a little different way. We wanted to see what else is happening, and we're suspecting that there is a gas release. So we put this little wire with the coating inside a little chamber, which we evacuated. So it was done now in a vacuum. We don't need the environment. It's a thermite reaction. So we repeated the same experiment as the coated wire. And we did the same measurement, but in addition to optically triggering, seeing the ignition mechanism and temperature, we also looked at pressure. And so now I'm going to show you what that looks like. So let's take one at a time. So let's take this plot. There's a lot of things here. So this blue is a temperature. So that's my heating ramp. This is my pressure. And this is my optical signal. And so one thing which strikes you right away, if you think about this, your pressure comes up before you start seeing the light. So you produce pressure before the stuff ignites. And you see this is a pattern that you see for all three thermites that I show here, especially here for copper oxide, for which I showed you the model. Pressure goes up, and the light's not up for a while. So we were pretty struck by this. We expected the other way around. We expected to see light and then pressure, because we thought, OK, well, copper is going to boil off, so we're going to get a little pressure. But this is different. Copper's not boiling off, because it's not even ignited. So copper can't boil off. So what should it be? So we've seen this difference between pressure and emission signal, which was puzzling. And they figured this got to be due to oxygen release from decomposing copper oxide, which is consistent with the results from Zakaria group. But they used mixed powder. So they look, it's kind of looking similar, but there are two differences. One is they use powders and not composites like us. And two, they do their experiment in a high vacuum. So in a high vacuum, copper oxide can decompose at a low temperature because high vacuum is a reducing environment. We tried our experiments with the nano copper oxide and with any kind of copper oxide, milled copper oxide. Nothing happens unless it is aluminum that's milled with it. So, you know, it's clear to us that in our experiment, it is aluminum that makes this oxygen. And so the nagging question is, why is this oxygen coming out when I have all this aluminum in the world and around it, which wants to consume it and which causes this in the first place? So my copper oxide is not metastable. I know this. I have reducing agent. Why do I have oxygen coming out? But it certainly affects ignition because it disrupts my heat transfer with the wire. Remember I showed you that spike which went down? Why was it going down? Because the powder sits on a metal wire. And so when the powder is not ignited, wire is a heater. Well, once the powder is ignited, wire is a cooler. It keeps the temperature, so powder is thermally attached to it. So if you have the gas, you disturb this, and the powder can run away. So let's try to explain now this thing, going back to the model that I showed you, right? So remember I showed you a model predicts DSC. So in that model, we really predict the reaction that happens upon heating. So what this plot shows you, now this is a temperature, this is heating rate, and each line shows you how much oxygen I consume depending on these conditions. So for example, at 1,000 heating rate, by getting to 670, I consume 2% of oxygen. This is my pre-ignition reaction, that reaction that, you know, really produces these spikes on the DSC. So that's not small amounts. So depending on the heating rate, of course, the higher temperature, higher heating rate, I have higher consumption of oxygen to these temperatures. So obviously, 3% is happening at a higher temperature than 2%, and 5% even higher temperature. Now, this is where I predict my heat flow spike in my model. So this is all coming from the model. Now, let me overlap it with the ignition temperatures. So ignition temperatures happen right here, which is kind of correlating with my heat flow spike, like I said. So I already knew that. What I didn't realize is that by that time, I am consuming from 3 to 5% of oxygen from my system. Which means what? Which means I don't have CuO anymore, which is what I have in all my benchmark experiments. I have CuO1 minus X, so that's a metastable oxide. It's partially reduced oxide. So this probably is metastable at these temperatures, and it can release oxygen even without aluminum provoking the reaction. So I first form metastable oxide in the pre-ignition reaction, and when I come to some point, it decomposes, and that triggers ignition because that separates my wire from the powder. So this is, I think, you know, if I look at these numbers, now these numbers are bulk, right? So that's the entire amount of oxygen that I talk about. In reality, close to the interface, I must be consuming even more. Because like far from the interface, think about this 100 nanometer inclusion. In the center of this inclusion, it's probably still nice CuO. But on the boundary, which is close to aluminum, it's got to be a very much reduced CuO. And that's the stuff that's decomposing. So I think, to us, this was acceptable explanation. So what we see is fully dense thermites ignite with gas release before ignition, which we observe by pressure from the light pulse. We assign this to oxygen generation, and we say that this generation is only possible when you have metastable oxide. And this metastable oxide forms at a rate which we get from the kinetics that we get from DSC. So somewhat convoluted, but still kind of works. So now ignition temperatures really correlate with the amorphous to alumina transition, which happens to be that when the oxide, when the spike is produced, this is what's causing the spike. And then oxygen released, and that causes the runaway of the temperature. So like I say, the model is not as simple as I'd like it to be, but I think it works. Okay. So the last part is combustion of reactive materials. Remember, do they remember nanostructure? So typically we burn at temperatures way exceeding melting point of aluminum, so you would expect that, you know, forget about aluminum-based materials remembering anything, and nanostructure is not preserved. what makes us made us think about this is this experiment. So it's a long diagram, but really what you see is a sample holder and a pin electrode, and this is high voltage power supply. So you make a spark and you look at something like this. So you ignite the material and you form, you know, a flame. So it's a spark ignition, very typical safety test for materials. And we had a project where we looked at the mechanism of this thing. So we looked at the monolayer. So we put the one layer of particles here. And then in the separate experiments, we had a 2 millimeter, half a millimeter or 1 millimeter deep cups. So we had a little layer of stuff ignited. And we've noticed something interesting. In a monolayer, this is a monolayer ignition. So this is your powder holder. You ignite it, and it ignites instantaneously. So the spark duration is like up to 10 microseconds, so you understand. And the ignition happens within that time frame. And we see it's happening very fast. Single particles fly out and burn, so, you know, nice. And then when we have a thicker layer, this is a video of what that looks like. And so that, you see, creates a cloud. It's the same powder. It creates a cloud, and then it burns for a long time. So if I look at the time, so this is a key. Burn times here were 150 to 500 microseconds. Burn times here were 5 to 10 milliseconds. Same stuff. So we're like, how can that be even possible? We burn the same thing. So now we say, OK, well, maybe this is a cloud because, you know, different type of reaction. But the times difference is still like tremendous. So same result if I look at the burn time, like optical signal from monolayer. So this is a time scale in log coordinates. This is ending up right here, and this keeps going on and on and on. So very different time scales. So we think, what's happening? We look at the temperatures. Monolayer, so this is coming from, we have a 32 wavelength pyrometer, so we measure 32 temperatures with time resolution, then we get the, we process it using Planck's formula, get a temperature. So this is a temperature for monolayer. So you see it's like above 3,000. And then this is a thicker layer, longer time, and the temperature just above 2,000. Big difference. So not only time's a difference, temperature different. So something is really different here. And then we collect the products. And we see that, well, look, these are products from a monolayer. And so 2 microns, so this is a particle. So we see like a large chunks of aluminum oxide, but we see also very kind of fine mixing. And this is from the thicker layer. So 10 micron scale bar, that's a humongous particle which is nicely separating aluminum oxide from copper. That's what we would expect to see normally. You know, like everything melts, coagulates, and that's your product. This was kind of, what is it? It looks like it's preserving the structure somehow. So we went and did another experiment to eliminate the situation that in one case we'll look at single particles, in the other case we'll look at the cloud combustion. So we put particles through a laser beam, same material, ignited with a laser, and now, so that's kind of what it looks like. And so we can see how fast that burns. In this case, the heating happens of the particle happens at the rate of about 1 million Kelvin per second. Sounds fast, but it's not that fast as in a spark. In a spark, we're heating this with 1 billion Kelvin per second. So there's a difference. So if I compare my laser ignition pulse and my spark pulse, so here are the emission traces, and look at the time scales. Laser ignition, 3 milliseconds. Spark, 100 microseconds. So again, a huge difference. Now, in both, now this is one particle, I know that. This is many particles, so this is probably produced by the largest one in the batch. Like, all of them contribute. So again, we have a very different burn rates for the same material. All we change is how we heat it. 10 to the 6 million Kelvin per second and billion Kelvin per second. So we heat a different rate, and we get a different burn rate. So something is really changing. So we look at the burn time like more like significantly, and again, this is work in progress. So this is multiple thermites, so those are oxidizers, all of them aluminum-based. And so what I show you, the average burn times for the same powder. So this is a laser-ignited particle, one particle. This is a log scale, so this difference is huge, right? And this is the entire powder. which contains all these particles. And if I further modify this and I add the range of single particle burn times, that becomes even more significant. So the averages show one thing, but for example here, even if I compare, the average is almost the same, but the range of single particle time is this. Now, if I think about this ESD ignited, spark ignited monolayer should include all these particles. So instead of having what, like a 10,000 microsecond as I see here, I only have, you know, what's 300-400. So very different burn times. So this is our idea, what's happening, how this remembers. So we start with this composite material. And the material is like inclusions of oxidizer and the matrix of aluminum. So at slow heating, 10 to the 6. Now, slow compared to what? Compared to heat propagation through the material and compared to the time that it takes to melt. So you have low heating rate. We don't have many temperature gradients. So we have a molten pool. It pulls aluminum together. Aluminum, the oxide inclusions agglomerate. So once it ignites, it completely forgets its initial structure. If we have rapid heating, then we have strong temperature gradients. And so before the entire thing is molten, the reaction already starts. So part of the material react where the other parts are still being heated. So those parts that react, they release gas and they produce cracks. And then that breaks the particle apart. And that basically it preserves it from coagulating and forming one big molten pool. And so we think that this is the mechanism of rapid combustion. And again, I can't see how that can be occurring in any other material, but with this type of structure. So with this, I'll just finish. So we talked about many materials that we can ball mill and prepare by milling, many different applications, tests and new applications explored every day. We're looking at the reactive surface accelerated ignition. So I thought that's pretty unusual mechanism where we have reduced ignition delays and metastable phases that now we know how they form, and they affect the ignition in ways that I don't think was clear at all. And we see also that the initiation method can affect how the materials burn. And that basically tells you that you can tune performance by heating them at different rates if you have these structures. So with this, I thank you all again for coming and listening to this.
The energy transfer rate that you said you can calculate. I'm wondering what kind of approximations you have to put in there to get any idea of what's actually flowing from where to where.
Yeah. So you can be kind of stupid about it and say we have this discrete element model, right, which calculates right. Pretty much all kinds of, it predicts all kinds of collisions. So first step to make it work is to have proper conditions in this model. And that means you have to have proper relaxation coefficients and proper friction coefficients because the energy transferred by both. And we typically don't know those too well. So in our case, we had to calibrate the model. So we had to do a specific experiment. For example, we take one ball, we coat it a little bit of powder, make it roll in the mill, and calculate how the oscillation relaxes. And then we tune our model to predict this kind of relaxation. That way we know rolling friction, for example. That's one step, you do this. And then you say, okay, you have output, and the output comes in the way of each collision produces you energy and the duration. So you have like a power in a collision and the total energy in a collision. And it turns out that you have to cut out all the collisions which have less than a threshold energy because they don't do anything. So if you, and there's a lot of them with low energy. Right. So once you cut out those, you end up with mostly useful collisions. And then if your model is right, then that's all you need to do. If your model is wrong, like ours was when before we started looking at the impeller changing its parameters, we had some very strong energies and they like skewed everything out. And when we started looking at them, we said they're not physical. Where they come from. And once we figured it out, we say, okay, one way is just to cut them and say, well, they're stupid and we're not going to count them. But the other way was let's change the model to not have it. So you can do it. Nowadays, you can change the model and not have it. So as soon as you account for proper collision parameters and sieve off all the below threshold energies, then I think your output from the model is straight feeding into what you need.
So then if you change the material, do you need to recalibrate, or can you do it with the physical parameters, such as, you know, heat capacity and density and so forth?
Yeah, so if you change milling balls, you definitely can, you don't have to recalibrate because we mostly know mechanical parameters of the milling balls. Mm-hmm. I think the tricky part is that the milling balls get coated with the powder in the process, and that coating changes the mechanical properties. So to be safe, I would recalibrate at this point. Mm-hmm. But that's relatively easy because you can do in a lab experiment, you can like do small scale, and then you recalibrate that effect. So you don't have to go to a large scale.
But then you can easily extrapolate from the small to the large scale.
Right. Yeah, this is just a calculation. Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. Yeah. Let me come over to you, John.
So thank you so much.
It's on.
It's on. Okay. Yeah. So I have lots of questions, but thank you for the very complete and systematic study on nanothermal stuff. So the first item I want to clarify, all the samples you used was prepared by milling, right?
In combustion experiments, yeah. I mean, we're not above burning anything, but most of our work is about preparing materials by milling and testing them.
Yeah. So milling sometimes give you some activation, right? So kind of so you compare to the other sample, maybe the raw material different, because if you mill your sample, you add energy and you generate lots of defects. So
the most direct comparison that we've done was for aluminum-magnesium alloys, because aluminum-magnesium alloys you can readily get done by mixing melts. So we have commercial aluminum-magnesium alloy, which is AL12-Mg17 system, nice spherical particles. And we compared them to mechanically alloyed aluminum-magnesium, which has very different structure. So we have that work done. And that comparison is, I think, interesting, telling, and you know, it tells you what the differences are. For everything else, is really hard to get. Like if thermites we're talking about, like there is no analog to a composite particle which has metal and oxidizer mixed in a fine scale. There's just no material like this. So I can compare to nanothermite, but then I have to come up with a specific experiment. I can, for example, press a pellet, or like we're doing. Now we're working with Lawrence Livermore, and they try to burn stuff in a tube, so they like produce this thermite cloud and do propagation of flames. So they compare our thermite with nanoparticle mixed thermite with the same composition. And we've done that, some sort of comparisons like this for several thermites ourselves. But then that's comparing just special aspects of combustion, so you can't be generic about it. You know, if you want to talk about how the pellet ignites, we can do this. But the particle combustion, no.
Yeah. So for formation of a metal stable oxide, right? So is it possible to, you know, to stop somewhere, stop your reaction somewhere, then we can exactly measure, or characterize the formation of this thing?
Yes, but it's very difficult. Because, for example, I don't know how to characterize this partially reduced oxide. I literally don't know how to do it because we thought about this. And maybe very high resolution TEM, some kind of scanning method would kind of show this. Unfortunately, I don't have this to my disposal and it's too expensive to just go out and play. But that's the kind of thing that would be useful. But so the answer is, I think, yes, but it's tough and we haven't done. Mm.
Last question. So how do you make that nanoparticle thermite? So you have a nanoparticle generator. So what? How does?
No.
You have a single particle combustion, right?
So you have. How we feed that?
Yeah. How do you produce this?
So we have powder, right? So from the bone mill, we have a powder, and the particle size distribution is in 10 micron range, something like this. So we have this powder. So we feed these powders in different systems. So we've done range of different feeders, and the latest one is, it's a screw, like a large screw. We paint some of the powder on the screw, I would put the screw inside a tube, and we have a blower on one side, which kind of serves also to move the screw around. And on the other side of the blower, we have a tube. And so we start blowing the gas, and as the screw moves, we're blowing a little bit of that powder out, and then it just feeds into the flame, and that works fine.
Do you think it's possible to have like a core shell composite particles instead of you have a...
So, yes, but then, you know, it's similar question to how to change a particle size. So when you start making a powder, you make, the bone milling makes composite, it doesn't make core shell. But what you can do is you can, for example, add a material that you want to have on the shell later. And if it's a ductile material, it's going to form your shell. So you can make material like this. You can make fascinating things with this. You can in situ consolidate and make Lausdorff balls and all this. So different things are being done. But people do coatings. So that obviously you can do core shell particles. But that will be limited in terms of what you can put on where. Making composites like pretty much unlimited. But once you start coming out with special morphologies, the answer is yes, but let's see what specifically you want.
Great, thank you.
More questions?
Yeah. I have two questions about the safety challenges. I have two questions about the safety challenges.
Yes.
You mentioned that you have safety issues about the prevention of a reaction during milling.
Right.
How did you make it?
So how to prevent reaction during milling, the easiest way is to use a liquid in the mill. So what we typically use when we work with the reactive material is the hydrocarbon, like hexane or heptane or something like this. So it sounds a little counterintuitive because that's a flammable liquid, but with no oxygen, it's very harmless. So inside the mill, it has nothing to react with, right? So your metals don't react with hydrocarbons, your oxides don't react with it, so it's just inert medium for this. And then once you recover it, there are two things. You can keep it in the liquid, and then if you want to formulate, say, a propellant or something, in many cases, those hydrocarbon liquids are processed liquids. So you can never expose your material to air, so it's very safe. If you need to expose it, then it's already like a separate thing. You dry it, but you know, you have to be careful not to ignite it. So in the lab, what we do and what most people do is when you want to have a dry powder out of this wet powder, we put in a glove box, argon-filled glove box, which has low concentration of oxygen. And we kind of expose it for some time. Then we take a little bit out and see if it's not pyrophoric, then we work with it. Sometimes it is, so we keep it longer. So you got to be very careful because we unfortunately had incidents, so we kind of try to learn from it and not repeat mistakes. But yeah, these materials can be very dangerous if they are reacting in your face.
So my second question is it safe to put the materials you synthesized by milling in the air?
Yeah, we use them in the air all the time, right.
Okay, so it's safe, you just put them...
Well, again, like I said, you have to test your material so it's not pyrophoric. Sometimes these materials are pyrophoric and that's not safe at all. So the worst thing you can do is open the bone mill with dry powder in the air. That's like absolutely worst thing you can do because then you have a lot of powder in and it starts reacting, you don't even know because it reacts slowly, but then it self-heats and explodes. And that's the most dangerous thing. So you want to open this stuff if you're making reactive material inside a protective environment or under a liquid. If you're doing it under a liquid, then no problem. Because like, if it's wet, you can open it all you want.
I mean, after you dry all the materials, is it safe to...
So yeah, if you passivate it, you have to passivate it and test small amount and see if it's not pyrophoric, and then you can work with it.
Oh, thank you for your presentation. And I have several questions. First of all, in your result, and there's pressure increase first, and then optical signal come up. And so you think for the pressure increase because of the oxygen release, right? So why is there any possible just because of the other material evaporated and increase the pressure?
So I have aluminum, copper, and oxygen. Copper. What else?
Maybe copper.
Why would copper evaporate at such a low temperature? That's like, it doesn't. Copper would evaporate at much, we don't even come to the melting of copper, so the vapor pressure of copper is like nothing. So this is like by exclusion, we don't have anything else to go. In addition, like I say, we compared our stuff with Zachariah's work, and he observed similar gas release in a similar temperature range in a highly reduced environment. In his experiment, he uses a mass spec. So he cannot measure pressure, but he measures actually species that come out, and he sees its oxygen. So he does know how much. We know how much. We don't know what it is. He knows what it is, but he doesn't know how much. So put two together, it's oxygen.
So it means the oxygen release first and react with the aluminum. But I have one more question. Because you have DSC result, right? And whether there is a couple with TGA together?
Yeah, we have that, sure, yeah.
Yeah, because I think for the aluminum and the copper oxide, we mix them together and heat up in DSC, and there's no TGA drop.
No, in DSC it doesn't happen. It does not happen. Okay. Oxygen is not released continuously. It's only released when you have runaway reaction. When you overheat your copper oxide a little higher. So we never get to there in DSC. In DSC, we never run away. We always control the situation. So we react slowly. We produce this metastable copper oxide, but we never heat it above the decomposition temperature. So it's only heated. Remember this spike I predicted. This spike gets, it doesn't get us to the copper boiling, but it certainly gets us to the, you know, decomposition of this metastable CuO.
Oh, it means for the wire. You coat the thermite on the wire, and then ignite, pressure increase. And because pressure increases because of the oxygen decompose, right? It means not the same temperature with the DSC inside of the ignition.
You heat the wire, and as you go through the heating ramp, you slowly reacting copper oxide. So your copper oxide becomes CuO1 minus X. At some point, something else happens in the model. My aluminum oxide that's growing goes through a phase change. So my reaction rate accelerates rapidly. That produces a jump in heat release. And at that point, my CuO1 minus X is turning out to be metastable. And it produces gas. It's still low temperature to see optically, but it's, you know, high enough for CuO to decompose. And then I break my particles off the wire, and then they are independently heated.
Okay. So. Could I think this like in the wire ignition, it's the oxygen, before the oxygen release, there's a reaction already happens.
Absolutely.
Yes,
that's
yes.
The whole point. Yeah.
Yeah, yes, yes. So it's the oxygen not released just at the ignition point, higher
only
than
the
ignition.
Point.
After the ignition and the oxygen release. Because if the oxygen release at the moment of ignition, the TGA should be dropped.
But you don't ignite stuff in TGA. I never ignite stuff in TGA.
If
you ignite stuff in the TGA, I mean, the hell breaks loose. Everything's going to go down, and you produce copper.
But in TGA DIC, the ignition happens just with a different reaction rate, right?
No.
Huh?
No.
No, no.
You don't ignite in TGA. I mean, if you do it right, you don't ignite.
But the reaction happens in TGA DIC, right?
Correct.
But not ignite.
Ignition means runaway of temperature. That's what ignition means. And if your TGA is done right, you don't ignite. You can see reaction, but you always control the temperature. That's the proper TGA experiment. You control the temperature of a sample.
Yeah, yeah.
So by definition, you don't ignite anything.
Oh, but in TGA DSC and the wire, for the reaction happens with under different temperature? I think it should be under
Well, the kinetics predicts that it should be a little different, and we're observing it where we're kind of predicting it. Because wire goes to much higher heating
rate, so
it shifts to higher temperature, and that's where we observe it.
Oh, so should be higher temperature igniting in the wire.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, maybe one more question.
And I asked you about, I believe it was a conium-boron nanocomposite you showed. You are stopping, of course, the reaction before it really takes off.
Right.
But with these small boron sizes, do you think you have zirconium boride already formed at the interfaces?
That's a good question, because I don't see evidence of that, but obviously something must happen. I mean, the interface structure is like the biggest unknown in these materials, and it's kind of very interesting to investigate it. So I think the only thing to do this, again, that I know of, is a really high resolution TEM, for which you need to really prepare your sample properly, which is not easy for these materials. So there must be some reaction. Now, based on the heat release that we measure from DSC and the heat of combustion and everything, it doesn't seem like we're producing anything detectable. So for example, nanoaluminum, typical nanoaluminum has oxide layer of like, what, 3 to 5 nanometers. And if you make a reactive system with it, it's about 30 to 40% energy loss just because of that. We're not seeing anything like this. So if there is something, and there must be something, but I don't know what it is.
I guess if you prepare the sample for TEM, you might actually prepare the zirconium boride at the interface by the milling.
Yeah, well, now with the, what is it, FIB, I think you can probably do something. And again, like, I don't have that FIB, so. Yeah, so we can try and look at that. That would be very interesting.
Okay, then let's thank our speaker again.
Thank you
very much.